Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us bright and early. Today, we have a talk on the invention of race and race-based medicine. Okay, so the objectives for the talk today are to understand the history and construction of race in the United States, to understand the difference between race and ethnicity, and to understand the implications of using race and ethnicity in medical decision-making. So to address this first objective, to understand the history and construction of race in the United States, we have are very lucky to have Dr. Chip Colwell. He is the editor-in-chief of sapiens.org, which is an anthropology magazine. And he his work has focused on repatriation of human remains and sacred objects. And recently his work has shifted also to include ethics of genetic research in the study of ancient human remains. So I will stop sharing my screen and thank you so much, Dr. Colwell.
Thank you, Dr. Sergew. Good morning, everyone. So I'm an anthropologist, as Dr. Sergew mentioned, and anthropologists often start with a land acknowledgement, which is just a moment to pause and reflect on who's Native Americans' traditional lands that we're now on. So I'm zooming in here from Denver. And Denver is the traditional lands of the Cheyenne, Arapaho, Lakota, and Ute peoples. And here in Colorado, it's the traditional lands of 48 historic tribes now spread throughout the Rocky Mountains, American Southwest, and Great Plains. So this is our family tree. We got our start about 2.5 million years ago with the emergence of the genus called Homo. And there were many different species of humans throughout those 2.5 million years ago. But over those 2.5 million years, but about 300,000 years ago, anatomically modern humans emerged. And by about 40,000 years ago, we are the only Homo species left on Earth. We are all one species, although we may look different, although we have different geographic histories, we are all 99.9% similar genetically, and we are all one species as biologists define the species. So this isn't to say that there aren't differences between or among specific populations. But these variations have evolutionary explanations that rarely align neatly with our categories of race. So let's take, for example, skin pigmentation. So anthropologists believe that this is a trait, it's a polygenic trait, meaning there's different parts of our genome that control for skin pigmentation. And this emerged as an adaptation to UV radiation, most likely, as humans spread around the globe and occupied coastal areas, high mountains, and other areas that required us to have greater defenses to be able to absorb vitamin D based on our geographic location. And this has a very deep history, probably emerging about 1 million years ago. So in other words, skin pigmentation and our genetic adaptation to it arrived long before modern Homo sapiens. And it's important to acknowledge that that something like this is widely shared. There are many genes that code for pigmentation across so-called racial groups, right? So for example, there's one gene that lightens skins that's found in both European populations and the San, which is an indigenous group of Botswana. So even though we might see those two groups and they look very, very differently, in fact, they share some of the same genetic coding for skin pigmentation. In short, race does not come from evolution. It was invented. And most specifically, race was invented during European colonialism over the last 500 years. So in 1492, Christopher Columbus stumbled on the Americas. He thought he was headed to India. And so he named the people he came across Indios. But this was not a benevolent trip. Very quickly, Columbus and his peers set out to conquer the Americas, to subjugate Native American people. And they did this for the purposes of mining. They needed laborers to build infrastructure. They needed farmers to work plantations. They needed sailors to ship goods. And they used both men and women for sexual servitude. But even as the Spaniards and other Europeans perpetrated horrific acts upon Native peoples, they needed a way to justify this to themselves. And initially, many did this by questioning whether or not Native Americans could reason and whether or not they had souls. And so there was great debates over many decades, whether or not, in short, Indians were in fact human beings or they were animals. What's important to note here is that even the great defenders of Indian peoples, such as Bartolome de las Casas, believed that while Native Americans had souls and should not be enslaved, people from Africa should actually replace the people who were enslaved in the Americas. So he saw Africans as not having a soul and therefore not humans. And it really wasn't until the late 1500s that this debate was finally resolved. And it was resolved at last that Native Americans, as well as people from Africa, are human. But then the Spaniards needed some new way of justifying the exploitation and subjugation of the people in their colonies. And so they did this by creating a caste system. They put at the top people from Spain, born and raised in the peninsula of Slain, of Spain. Then beneath that, you had the people whose families could be traced to the peninsula, Criollos, but were born in the New World, in the Americas. Beneath that, you had mestizos and mulattos, which was a combination of people from Africa and people from the Americas, indigenous peoples from the Americas. And then at the very bottom, you had indios, Native Americans, and negros, people from Africa. And as you can imagine, you know, this very quickly, this system becomes very complex because you might have grandparents that are different combinations and so on and so forth. And so you see here on your left, a picture of the several dozen castes that were created to make the system work. This became very intricate, and this was to determine unchangeable social status. It was assigned at birth. Was based on your perceived lineage of geography and race. And it basically determined everything about your life, what kind of work you would do, what kind of clothes you would wear, where you could live. Did you have access to the courts? In other words, did you have basic rights, whether or not you could own land and so on. One might ask, maybe the Spaniards were just using race because people look different. And so when you see people as different and you want to create a hierarchy, then why not use race? Well, if that is true, then we can look to other empires throughout human history, and they should also be using race, right? If that's just a natural way of denoting difference. So let's, for example, look at the Roman Empire. The Romans, we know based on writings as well as their arts that they did note different body types. We know that they traveled probably as far as the Arctic and definitively as far as the Far East, China, in the second century AD. And yet the Romans lacked really any notion of our modern notion of race. They did have a hierarchy, but it was based entirely on class. And they did have people who were enslaved, but here also it was not based on race. It was actually based on this class system. And here we have, for example, an illustration that archaeologists believe is of a person who's enslaved and the slave owner, and they both seem to have the same skin pigmentation. Well, how about the Mongol Empire? The Mongol Empire was one of the biggest in human history, stretching all the way from Europe to East Asia into South Asia, up into Siberia. And they too lacked any notion of race. They also had a hierarchy. Where they placed themselves, the Mongols, as an ethnic group at the very top. But below that was really based on the relative distance, ethnic distance from the Mongol people. They also had slavery, most often as new cities or villages were conquered. Those people would be enslaved, but they would be enslaved temporarily. And again, based not on any notion of race. So if race was a natural way of categorizing human beings, we'd expect to see all empires encountering different looking people to have conceived of racial groups. But that is not the case. Race is the single and terrible inheritance of European colonialism. And the Spanish caste system was adopted by other European powers, most notably those of Northern Europe. So in what became the United States, as people from England and United Kingdom migrated to the eastern coast of the United States, they replicated a caste system, but in their own terms. From the very first, those settlers brought with them enslaved Africans, and they quickly enslaved some Native Americans. They also brought with them people who would have looked like me, people from Northern Europe who were indentured servants. Massachusetts becomes the first colony to legalize slavery, and then several decades later, Virginia becomes the first to enact a law of hereditary slavery, meaning that if you were a child born of an enslaved person prior to 1662, you were actually free. After 1662, it becomes genealogical. Essentially, you inherit your caste from your parents. And then a singularly important event unfolds in 1676, which is Bacon's Rebellion, in which indentured servants lead a rebellion. And that's where European colonists from Northern Europe decide that it's much easier to create a caste system based on people, on how they look, rather than their social status. So essentially they do away with indentured servants, people from Europe who were essentially treated as free labor. And they base the free labor system entirely on race, on the construction of race, and especially blackness. What's really clear when you look back in the historical record is that race, as we know it today, actually had to be invented. These terms and notions were not self-evident at all, but rather over time, new ideas of race were introduced. So for example, in 1613, this is the first use of the modern notion of white people. In 1684, a French physician, François Bernier, publishes the notion on the idea that there are different species or races of men, that somehow maybe there's not a unitary relationship from a Western perspective of what it means to be human. And in 1735, the great Swedish naturalist, Carl Linnaeus, in his description of the natural world with the use of binomial nomenclature, he adds in humans as if they are different species. And he goes so far as to describe those different species of humans. And to give you a sense of, from our view today, how absurd some of these categories are, but also to show that these aren't just innocuous descriptions of physical, of what people look like, but actually it was a value system, a kind of judgment of these different supposed groups of people. We could look, for example, at Linnaeus's description of Asiaticus fuscus, which he described as people with blackish hair, dark eyes, people who were stern, haughty, and greedy. And lastly, the Philadelphia physician, Samuel Morton, collects about 1,300 skulls of heads of different people from around the world, often in quite nefarious ways. And he then believes that he can describe five different races, as well as different kinds of temperaments and characters for these different races. So again, he's constructing a hierarchy with people from Europe and Native Americans actually at the top and people from Africa at the bottom. But to give you a sense of how today we've inherited these five categories, all we have to do is look at our census and the census data and how the census data is collected. And these five categories, these five basic categories are still with us almost 200 years later, even though we know the premise of these categories are absurd. And to point out too that Samuel Morton and his contemporaries, again, were constructing race not just as a kind of passive scientific observation. They're doing this as a way to justify the inequalities that exist throughout the United States. So in other words, this is race in the service of caste. So race is used, Morton's science, so-called science, pseudoscience, as well as those of his colleagues, are it's being used to perpetuate slavery, later segregation and Jim Crow, eugenics, Nazism, and even neo-Nazism today. And these sorts of things would shape, these sorts of constructions would shape people's access to healthcare, education, shape immigration policy, who's even a citizen. Native Americans, for example, weren't even legally Native American citizens until 1924. Most didn't even have the actual ability to vote until the 1960s. So these constructions of race and these hierarchies have very real world effects. The key point here is though that race is powerful because it is used for power. Race feels dehumanizing because it was intended to be dehumanizing. It literally started with the question of whether or not Indians and people from Africa are human. Race is implicitly hierarchical today because it was explicitly invented to be hierarchical. Race is a caste system. And race limits who people can become because it was created to control people economically, politically, and bodily. So race is not real. It was invented. It's an invented construction. And yet the way race has played out has very real world effects, whether we look at things like maternal mortality rate, household wealth, and so many other categories of contemporary life. And race is imagined, right? It was made up. It was invented before 1613. The concept of white, for example, didn't even exist. And yet over the centuries, we collectively keep reimagining it. So for example, I love this quote from Benjamin Franklin from the late 1750s, a great, he was a very important American polymath and thinker of the time. And he talked about how Germans, people from Germany, because of their behavior and because of their complexion, could never be white, could never be like people from England like him. And so over time, even the notion of whiteness has morphed over time, particularly as people from Ireland, people who are Jewish, Italians, Armenians, people who identify as Hispanic, people from the Middle East, all become white over time. We can also see this if we look at those census categories over time. We see how different sorts of labels are added at different points and how these labels shift and often are vague in general, and how we're still living with the legacy of some of these terms. So for example, Chinese was added in 1870, but it was to describe all people from East Asia. We see the institution of the so-called one-drop rule, where even if you have any so-called blood from Africa, if there's any kinship at all from Africa, then that makes you black, and so on. And finally, race is a confused concept, and we are still confused by it. Several years ago, for my day job, I took one of these take-home DNA tests. And you see how it reports some of my lineage here, and it's described as ethnicity, right? And in fact, the first one, Ashkenazi Jewish, is an ethnic identity, meaning it's a cultural group to which I could belong, even though they're claiming it's in a genetic basis here. But then there's Irish, Scottish, and Welsh, which is actually a national identity. Then we have Middle Eastern, which is a geographic region. And then we have North African, which is, and Sephardic Jewish, which is a combination of geography and ethnicity. And yet, if we again look at the census definition of white, what this test result is telling me without telling me is that I am white. And yet we're using these terms and not using these terms, and we're combining an ethnicity, national geography in very confused ways. And so in conclusion, I want to say that race is a 500-year-old caste system to create and maintain power. And even though it's imagined and unjust, race has real effects, giving supremacy and resources to some and taking away the rights of others. For me, the silver lining to this really tragic and horrific story is that race was made by us. It was invented by us. So that means it can also be undone by us. It can also be unimagined by us. In short, race is neither inevitable nor permanent. So thank you very much. And I'll stick around if there might be any questions at the end.
Thank you so much, Dr. Colwell. So we'll take questions at the end here. So I'm gonna address this second objective to understand the difference between race and ethnicity. So as Dr. Colwell alluded to, race is not genetic. And to go with the anthropology theme, this is a statement from the American Association of Physical Anthropology. So race does not provide an accurate representation of human biological variation. And it has it was never accurate in the past, and it remains inaccurate when referencing contemporary human populations. And humans are not divided biologically into distinct continental types or racial genetic clusters. So what is the definition of race? So this is one definition that I found, and race is defined as a category of humankind that shares a certain distinctive physical trait. And very interestingly, I think when Chip was talking, it reminded me of Linnaeus's description. So, okay, so this person is white, they have blue eyes, they have blonde hair, so we would categorize them as white. This person is black, they have brown eyes, they have black hair, we would categorize them as black. Very interestingly, this was the cover of National Geographic, and these are twin sisters. And so that is where, to me, race is murky. Is race how you look? Is it how you identify? Is it how I think you look? Is it how you think you look? And yet we're using race in even some of our medical decision-making when it's in just looking at this, it can be quite murky. And how about ethnicity? Ethnicity is linked with cultural expression and identification. And so all of these people are black, all of these people are Ethiopian, but yet they have different ethnicities. They have different religions, foods, way of life, dress, etc. And so while we have this kind of Venn diagram shows it all, that we have ethnicity, race, nationality, but sometimes it can be confused. Race and ethnicity in itself can be quite confusing. And this was demonstrated in a tweet that Daniel sent out, where he wrote a paper on race and ethnicity. And one of his reviewers told him, race and ethnicity are the same, so I suggest that the authors remove one of them. And so I wanted to delve into that a bit more and talk about how ethnicity can be quite, race and ethnicity can be quite different. So to demonstrate that, I'm going to tell you the story of two University of Colorado internal medicine residents. The first is Max, and he's of Eastern European descent. He went to school, and he is from Argentina, born and raised, and did his medical school there as well. He moved to the United States, did research, and then did his prelim year as well as his residency, the rest of his residency at the University of Colorado. And the second is Daniel, and Daniel's parents are from the Soviet Union, the then Soviet Union, and they moved to the United States Daniel was born here, but he moved to Germany when he was in elementary school and did the remainder of his schooling there, as well as his medical school, and moved here to the US for his internship and came to Colorado for his second and third year. So these guys differ in terms of they're both white, in fact, from the same parts of Europe, but their ethnicity, Max being of Hispanic ethnicity, and their nationality are different. So they were the class of 2013, and in fact, classmates with Matt Griffith, that similar board scores, they were friends and had similar interests. And if these two guys were traveling anywhere outside of the US or outside of their own countries, they'd be treated the same because they are very, very similar. What I wanna talk to you is how their paths were quite different. So I asked Max how he was treated by his attendings. And Max talked about how his attendings tended to pimp him or ask him more questions because they were quite unsure as to whether he had similar knowledge as his peers. He felt that they did kind of try to get a better sense of his medical background. He also talked about how, although he was raised, born and raised, and that Spanish was his first language, and that he did his medical training in Spanish, that some of his attendings requested that he get a Spanish translator when he talked to his Spanish patients because he was not signed off on medical translation here in the United States. I asked Daniel if he felt any different, how he felt his attendants treated him, and he felt he was treated the same as his peers. This is Max, and I asked him how he was treated by his peers, and he talked about how sometimes interns would bypass him and talk with the attendings about the plan without ever talking to him. These are the same things that Josh talked about in our prior talk. He also talked about this one incident where he went to a residency party and it was a Halloween party. And one of his colleagues had said, "Hey, Max, look, I've dressed up as you," and started doing his accent and making fun of his accent. And Max notes that this was not the first time that someone was making fun of his accent, that he had experienced that multiple times, but his colleague felt that this was appropriate to do at a Halloween party, even though Max alerted him that that was not appropriate. I asked Daniel what his peers thought about him. He noted that he had no experiences where anyone made fun of his accent. He said his peers related to him very similar to how they did to each other, but if there was anything that was different, it was more curiosity. They did ask him about healthcare in Germany and the educational system in Germany, but he never had an incident where someone was making fun of his accent. And lastly, I'll talk about fellowship interviews. And Max was one of the most prepared for one of the best candidates that I've seen in regards to fellowship applications, in regards to the fact that he had a paper where he was a PI of a study, and he had two poster presentations and three oral presentations at a national meeting going into the specialty of interest. And so he had extensive amounts of research, and all of his peers and classmates assumed that he would get a spot. I asked him how his fellowship interview went, and he told me that when he arrived that day, they told him, "Oh, we don't have your fellowship application." And he said that he had received that they had received his application. They said they didn't. So he had to go to the office and print out his application, and he was asked to take his paper application from person to person of who he was interviewing with that day, which rattled him. And at the end, he didn't get the fellowship spot. And he said it wasn't that he didn't get the spot because it was a competitive fellowship. It really, to him, was that despite being qualified, that he was treated very differently than any other person that interviewed that day or had ever interviewed at that program. And it was that point that really made its mark. Daniel actually went into the same fellowship, applied in the same fellowship, noted that there was really nothing unusual about his fellowship experience, his fellowship interview experience. I wanted to play this video of Max to just give you a sense of him.
Start from the patients, okay? Sometimes patients are, they doubt that you are at the same level as any other doctors because you have an accent or you train somewhere else. When they don't know that we have to pass the same boards, and, you know, then you may have, you know, co-workers that have the same kind of, you know, idea. And also there's a little bit of, you know, I think I told you this, but I had a interaction with a resident kind of letting me know that I took the place of an American student, that she didn't see that as fair because I went to med school outside of the country and I didn't pay for tuition because university is free in Argentina. So animosity like that. Then, you know, you have attendings. I have an interaction with an attending that told me during rounds, well, I don't know how you do things out of the border, but here we do this, you know, things like that.
So in conclusion, neither race or ethnicity are detectable in the human genome. However, as we have seen in Max and Daniel's story, as well as in talking about this picture and these sisters, that these constructed perceptions that we have pretty significant consequences in shaping our human experiences. And I'm gonna turn the slides over to Matt, who's gonna address the next objective, understanding the implications of using race and ethnicity in medical decision-making.
Thanks, Amin. So we're going to focus this discussion primarily on PFTs, since that's the medical test adjusted for race that most of us are familiar with. So if you know much about spirometry, it was invented in the late 19th century. It was an exciting new technology and was used sort of broadly to in that time period to measure the differences between people and their bodies. One of the first widespread uses of this was in Union soldiers. And a study was published in 1869 looking at Union soldiers and found that white Union soldiers had significantly larger vital capacities than Black Union soldiers, who were mostly freed slaves or the children of slaves who grew up in slavery. And noticed that the Black soldiers had smaller vital capacities. And that became codified in the medical literature in 1922, one of the first times JAMA published an article on predictive, how to predict vital capacity for medical testing of children. And they said that things that mattered were age, height, and race. So yeah, it's just to say that in 1922, the first sort of predictive guidelines involving race were published in JAMA. And ever since then, every predictive set of algorithms for predicting vital capacity has included race alongside, physiologic measurements such as height and, height, age, and gender. And so these reflect a practice called race-based medicine, where we take this ill-defined concept of race that Dr. Colwell and Dr. Sergew have told you about, and we have made a study that links race with biology. So we say that people that appear Black in American history have smaller lungs. And so we reinforce this idea that Black people's genetics that control their lung volumes is different than white people's and must be accounted for. And so we tailor our clinical practices to this belief, which leads to racial health disparities. And we also do this in our epidemiologic type of research I do, where we notice that Black people, for example, don't do as well with, or do much better with heart failure than white people. And so we understand, or Black people, do not survive VBACs as well as white patients do. And so we developed practices that account for race in terms of our medical decision-making. These are both examples of race-based medicine. So explaining physiology with race and explaining clinical outcomes with race. And this article was published in Lancet in 2020 and suggests that we move to something called race conscious medicine, where we understand, like Dr. Colwell is saying, is that race is a social construct used to enforce power relationships between groups of people. And that this inherently leads to different treatment of these groups, as Dr. Colwell said, it was designed to, and that's what it does. And we understand the effects of this practice on health inequities. And by understanding it and addressing it, we can reduce them. So addressing these differences, not as biologically driven, but as driven by society and understanding their impact. And this article came out in Lancet last year, and there was a similar article in New England Journal looked at race-based medical testing, and it prompted the US House of Representatives Committee on Ways and Means to reach out to a number of professional societies, including ATS. And they asked ATS to investigate and change clinical decision support tools that, next slide please, Amin, that fuel racial inequities, specifically PFTs. And so this is a kind of a mandate, and this prompted our leadership here at CU to investigate the same process. And that's how I got involved, and some of you have heard me speak about this topic before. But how, when we say race is ill-defined, you've heard Chip say that and Amin say that, but how is that possible? We know that people with dark skin identify one way and must be very similar, and that must be helpful for medical testing. But actually, I remember reading this 20 years ago in the book for economics, but that it's been proven over and over again that larger genetic differences exist within Africa. I mean, that's where sort of the original human populations came from. And a small subset of this population left and colonized the rest of the world. But that the genetic variation within Africans is different than within Asians and Eurasians. So defining some pan-African race that's very similar is a myth. And comparing populations in the US to this pan-African race is not necessarily helpful. And this is even true within our country. So in terms of degree of African ancestry among people who identify as Black, there's a huge variation from state to state, which both reflects societal barriers to mixing between the races, as well as just what passes for white. So you can see someone in Washington state who identifies as Black is likely to have much lower African ancestry than someone who identifies as Black in South Carolina. So even within our country, this definition of who is Black, who is African American, varies substantially on who can pass based off their what environment. And if you were to look at Americans as a whole, you can see there's a gradient in terms of the relationships of genetic and racial self-defined race. And so, in America, once you get around 28% African ancestry, which is like one African grandparent, you are most likely going to identify as Black. Even though you have 72% European ancestry in America, that's kind of a magic number. And you can see, even on the far right of this graph, there are people who are, over 80% African genetically who still identify as European. And so again, asking people to self-identify their race and then using that in medical testing isn't really as cut and dry as we think. And it's sort of cut off here at the bottom, but people who identify as white are usually 99% European ancestry, whereas people who identify as Black on average in America are about 73% African ancestry. So again, one non-African grandparent equivalent. But again, a huge variance in genetics among who identifies as a specific race. And so we've codified this into many of our medical decisions, the self-identified race. So in Get With The Guidelines, heart failure mortality, being non-Black race adds 3 points to your risk, which means you'll get more aggressive treatment for the same physiologic for similar physiologic values if you identify as non-Black. So you get, you know, you'll be found to be more severe and get more aggressive treatment. For cardiac surgery mortality, again, for the same physiologic measurements, there's a 20% predicted increase risk of major complication following cardiac surgery for people who, again, self-identify as Black. And so they may not be offered the surgery. In terms of kidney transplant, Black race increased predicted risk of graft failure, which is actually, in the model, is a greater increase in predicted risk than having diabetes or hypertension in terms of predicting whether a transplanted graft will fail or not. So again, less likely to be transplanted. VBAC, like I said, again, even if you've, a woman who's had a VBAC has had a prior vaginal birth, she's still considered higher risk, you know, prior VBAC. She's still considered higher risk for subsequent VBAC if she's Black than a white woman who's never had a successful VBAC. In ureteral stones, again, Black race decreases the probability that a person presenting with flank pain is caused by ureteral stone. Again, for all the other same measurements, being Black, self-identifying as Black decreases the probability that your flank pain is caused by a stone. So you're less likely to get the standard painkillers and other treatments for kidney stone. And same with breast cancer risk, Black women are estimated to be at lower, again, self-identified Black women are estimated to be at lower risk for breast cancer than non-self-identified Black women, which means they're less likely to be offered early screening and more advanced imaging. And this is just, these are just a few examples. I'm sure you guys can think of many more. And so let's talk about PFTs. So what's our current ATS recommendation for PFTs? From Graham et al. In 2019. So for spirometry, they suggest using the GLI equations, which have four racial groups, Caucasian, African-American, which is not to say Black, it's African-American, Northeast Asian, and Southeast Asian. And they tell you to ask the patient, again, about their birth ethnicity. Just ask them what they self-identify as, and then use that in making your medical decisions. And if you don't want to ask them, you can assign race in a standardized way, as long as you state it in advance. So you can ask your techs just to determine what race they are without asking them. That's acceptable according to ATS. For lung volumes, the most recent document from ATS and ERS was Pellegrino in 2005. And they recommend using the Stokes equation from 1995, which has fixed race corrections. So calculate the value you would get for a white person. And then if they self-identify as African-American, Asian-American, or East Indian, multiply a reduction in those predicted volumes to get your total lung capacity. And many of you may know in the last few weeks, GLI has published lung volume standards. But again, they comment these are only to be used for patients of European ancestry. Again, further emphasizing there are important racial differences between groups. Same with DLCO. Again, most equations for like CREPO and other equations that many labs use do not have race, they have height and age in the DLCO equation. But just like their lung volume paper, GLI in 2017 published a paper again saying only use this for Caucasians. And it was again trying to acknowledge that their data was collected in non-whites, but again, further just says there's important differences between white lungs and Black lungs that we need to be aware of. And so just a reminder of who was enrolled in these GLI spirometry studies, because spirometry is mostly what we'll be talking about today, because it's the one that involves race most often. So they enrolled about, they gathered data. This wasn't a prospective trial. This was retrospective and gathering data of about 100,000 non-smokers in 73 centers in 33 countries. Among those 100,000, about half were Caucasians, and all Hispanics, anyone who spoke Spanish, was assigned a Caucasian race, whether you were like a Black descendant of slaves from the Dominican or a person of indigenous ancestry in northern Mexico. If you spoke Spanish, you were assigned Caucasian. They had 3,500 African Americans, so that's important when we talk more, about 5,000 Northeast people of Northeast Asian descent and 8,300 Southeast Asian descent. And there were 24,000 patients that were other, about a quarter. That includes anyone who was Black who was non-American, because again, they were only deriving values for African-Americans. So if you're Black and French, or Black and African. You were in the other category, as well as all French patients, actually, because the French government had removed race from the records that they allowed to be shared with GLI. So the French cohort, which was about 15,000 people, was white, Black, Arab, whatever. We don't know. So a pretty robust cohort. And just for comparison, next slide. If you guys remember using NHANES, they only had about 7,400 non-smokers in their entire cohort, about 2,300 Caucasians, 2,500 African-Americans. And then again, this idea of ethnicity and race sort of being, overlapped and used sort of interchangeably, they had 2,600 Mexican-Americans. And notably, next slide, no adults were excluded due to race. That means all adults enrolled in NHANES belonged or self-identified as one of these three groups. And then only 186 children, they had their race marked as other. And then again, they didn't discuss how race was assigned for people who did not identify as one of these groups. And so again, the GLI cohort is far more robust. And then race is a social construct. Again, I just think this is a good example of the sort of difficulty of using GLI and these racial categories in our modern country that we live in. I think Tyra Woods is a good example because his father is of African-American and Native American descent, and his mother is Chinese, Thai, and Caucasian. So he actually meets all five racial categories because Native Americans are encouraged. They don't identify as Hispanic, are codified as other in GLI. And so again, we have no idea, like looking at him, we would assume he was Black in America, but which of these racial corrections would accurately predict his lung function? We just have no idea. But we know, every observational study since the 1870s has shown that dark-skinned people have smaller lungs than light-skinned people. So that's a fact. You can't escape it, right? So it must be biologic. There must be a biologic difference between these groups that we must account for. However, we know that low birth weight is associated with lower adult vital capacity. Poor nutrition in childhood, fewer fruits and vegetables associated with lower lung function. Certainly the slaves in the 1860s had access to fewer fruits and fresh fruit and vegetable than the whites did. Ambient air pollution in childhood associated with lower lung function in children and adults. And secondhand smoke exposure in childhood is associated with lower lung function. So we know that vital capacity is not determined at birth. It's a function of your environment and your genetics. We know this, why Black-skinned people in America have lower lung volumes, as Blacks have the highest rate of low birth weight babies, double that of whites. Black and Hispanic children consume more sugar-sweetened beverages and fast food than white children. And predominantly Black neighborhoods have half as many supermarkets as predominantly white neighborhoods. Ambient air pollution in childhood associated with lower lung function in children and adults. Black and Hispanic adults are exposed to 60% more PM2.5 in their lifetime than the whites are. And secondhand smoke exposure in childhood is associated with lower lung function. And this is true, secondhand smoke exposure in the home is similar among white and Black children. However, Black children who do not live in secondhand smoke households have higher serum cotinine levels, which means that Black children are forced to inhabit environments where there's a lot more smokers than white children. So again, there's this, if you only look at height, age, gender, and race, race becomes a pool of unmeasured confounding, looking at all of these socioeconomic factors and, exposures that are different, just fundamentally different in the lives of white people and Black people in America. And they all just get sort of lumped into this idea that race is the catch-all variable. And whether it's confounding or effect modification, it's unclear because you can't find a Black person who, or a huge population of Black people in America that have lived the exact same lives as white people because of these factors. So this is an article that came out in 2010, and it gets sent to me frequently, every time I give this talk, where they looked at genetic ancestry and lung function predictions and looked at, the next slide. They found association degree of African genetic ancestry and lung volume. And again, the idea of there being a Pan-African race and that your association with this Pan-African race should predict something is difficult to understand because Africa is, again, the most genetically diverse population in the world. And so it's unclear, which of those genes drive lung function, similarity with this Pan-African race it's hard to know what that means. So the model included age, sex, height, smoking status, and BMI. Again, no socioeconomic factors, none of the exposures that we talked about in the last slide were not included in the model. And they now acknowledge as their second limitation in the study that the association they found between lung function and ancestry may be the result of factors other than genetic variation, such as premature birth, prenatal nutrition, socioeconomic status, and other environmental factors. So again, they acknowledge that their findings may be totally bogus because they could not account for these factors. Because you can ask someone what race they are, and they will tell you, but you cannot ask them how much PM2.5 have you been exposed to? How is your mother's nutrition prior to your birth? These are the things that probably matter, but we just can't ask, and so we don't. And yeah, and even again, this idea that we have to adjust for these values is another paper that gets sent to me, is that they did this study looking, kind of adjusting for risk of atherosclerosis, and found that vital capacity was essentially unassociated with risk of mortality among African-American and white populations in an unadjusted fashion. So it didn't matter among a population essentially of smokers or many smokers that the vital capacity was not actually associated with differently between whites and blacks in terms of risk of death. So it may not be something we even need to worry about. How does this practice affect patient care? So one of the obvious ways is in the lung allocation score for lung transplant. Non-white patients have lower LAS scores, which is lower priority for transplantation, for the exact same markers of disease severity, like 6-minute walk and diagnosis, and the same vital capacity. Because it uses percent predicted, the non-white patients will have a lower LAS score. And we know that non-white patients are listed with more advanced disease than white patients. So they may be experiencing delayed diagnosis under the current standard of care. And then ILD screening, again, I don't personally screen for ILD using these, but maybe some primary care docs do, and that may delay patients coming to see us to do more testing. And again, so Black patients would have a higher percent predicted FVC for the same measured FVC, but the effect on ultimate ILD diagnosis is unknown, because it's, again, unclear how often this practice is done. And then workers' comp. So if you look at all workers in jobs that require annual FVC testing, this is the distribution of vital capacities for white workers. And anything to the left of the line would qualify you for workers' compensation. And Black patients Black individuals who we know do jobs that expose them to higher risk of occupational injury and disease, the shaded section is the observed distribution of vital capacities among this group now. And so even using the adjustment for Black race, and then the box to the left is if we use the percent predicted FVC that would be generated for white patients. So by kind of adjusting down the predicted FVC for Black patients, we're probably missing patients with lung disease that would have been diagnosed if we applied the same standards as white patients. So what can we do? We can either just keep asking patients to self-identify and practicing this race-based medicine, or develop an approach that does not require racial identification. When I mention that to people, again, these are some of the concerns that come up, which I'm sure many of you are probably raising in the chat now, is that, well, if we start changing the predicted values for Black patients, we're going to have to make them pay for more imaging. We're going to make them appear less fit for jobs like firefighter or police officers, because again, healthy Black people we know must have lower FVCs than white people, and so they'll look unfit. They'll have to pay higher insurance premiums. And then people have emailed me worrying about the mental health of Black patients, being told they're disabled due to a change in testing. And I appreciate these concerns, but the possibility is that we're underdiagnosing them now by doing these, by adjusting down their predicted values. So, next. So again, as we learned today, races are defined by societies, not necessarily by biology, and racial identification is fluid depending on kind of which state you live in, which country you live in. It does not necessarily reflect genetic ancestry. Lung function is the product of genetics and environment. The contribution of each and effect modification is not well enough understood to say that race is the key factor, along with height, age, and gender, in predicting spirometry. And so we need better understanding. And race-based practice, where race is presumed to be biologic, leads to racial health inequities. So next step. These are things that we have proposed and that we would like to discuss in the few minutes we have left, is a division statement regarding race-based medical decision-making, an evaluation of our current practice, and potentially adopting a new standard. Because like I said, the leadership at CU, it really wants to comply with the House Ways and Means Committee letter, and are looking to us to lead the way. Thanks.
All right, we are over time, so we will close it out. Thank you so much to our guest speaker, Dr. Colwell, and thank you all for waking up early to join us today.